Let's start with shortness of breath. A lot of us experience that sometimes. Doctors call it dyspnea.
Dyspnea, yeah.
And like you point out, it's a pretty common symptom, right? But it can mean so many different things, some of them very serious.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you sent over a table about this, the differential diagnosis for dyspnea. And the thing that stood out to me right away is that it divides everything up into high mortality morbidity, emergent, and then usually less emergent. That right there tells you everything. If someone's having trouble breathing, the first thing is like, how urgent is this? Because if it's emergent, if it's in that high mortality category, those are life-threatening events. So recognizing the red flags, that's the first thing.
Okay, so let's take a look at that. We'll start with the respiratory side. So, emergent stuff on the respiratory side, we've got airway obstruction, maybe something stuck or swelling, like with epiglottitis or a bad allergic reaction, anaphylaxis, then pneumothorax, hemothorax, that's when air or blood gets in the space around the lung, and then gas exchange failure, pulmonary
Oh,
embolism,
yeah.
fluid in the lungs, pneumonia, or like a really bad asthma attack or a COPD flare-up. I mean, that is a lot of really, really serious stuff. Okay, and then on the less emergent side, the stuff that's usually not as urgent, on the respiratory side, we've got COPD, interstitial lung disease, also pleural effusions where fluid builds up outside the lung.
Yeah, that's right. So those are more chronic things that can cause shortness of breath, but usually it's over time, you know. It's not as sudden.
Okay, and then the cardiac side of this table, it's like a whole other set of serious issues.
Right. Same thing with the urgency there.
So high mortality morbidity, we see acute heart failure, CHF, heart attack, MI, then problems with the heart valves, cardiac tamponade. That's where fluid builds up around the heart and basically squeezes it.
Yeah, it can't pump properly.
Really bad. And arrhythmias, like irregular heartbeats, these are all really, really serious things. And then on the less emergent side, on the cardiac side, we see chronic heart failure and angina.
Yeah, angina is that chest pain from reduced blood flow to the heart. Still serious, for sure, but it's not as sudden as those other conditions.
Talked about key clues to diagnosis. This is basically like, okay, you have shortness of breath. What else is going on? That can give you a clue as to what the cause is.
Absolutely. The other symptoms can really narrow things down.
So, for example, fever, cough, and bringing up sputum.
Respiratory infection, classic presentation. The lungs are definitely involved there.
And then substernal chest pain.
So that's pain behind the breastbone. That makes you think cardiac ischemia, not enough blood flow to the heart.
And hives or swelling, like a rash.
Think anaphylaxis. That's a huge red flag.
And then wheezing. That's a sound we all kind of associate with breathing problems.
Wheezy. That's acute bronchospasm.
Asthma, COPD, those kind of things.
Exactly. Usually an asthma attack or a COPD flare-up. It means the airways are getting narrower.
And then you also mentioned that toxins in the environment or at work can cause breathing problems too.
Yeah, toxin-related dyspnea. So you really have to ask about what the person's been exposed to.
And then one more thing. The stuff you sent said that even if someone just has shortness of breath and nothing else, it could still be something like a PE or a pneumothorax.
Absolutely.
So even if it doesn't seem too bad at first, it's still important to get it checked out.
You can't be too careful.
So getting a good history is really important.
Crucial.
What about the physical exam? What are doctors looking for?
Well, the source you sent emphasized vital signs first thing. Heart rate, blood pressure, respiratory rate, oxygen levels, all the basics. Then they listen to the lungs with a stethoscope. And that can tell them a lot. Like if you hear wheezing or stridor, that high-pitched sound, that suggests an airway issue or a problem with ventilation. And then crackles, those usually mean there's fluid in the lung tissue.
Like from heart failure or pneumonia.
And of course, they do a heart exam too, looking for things like jugular venous pressure, JVP. That tells you about the pressure in the veins in the neck. It can mean fluid overload. And they listen for murmurs, which are unusual heart sounds.
So what if the history and the physical exam don't give a clear answer? What are the next steps?
Well, they'll probably run some blood tests. A CBC, that's a complete blood count, can check for anemia, which can cause shortness of breath. Electrolytes, you got to make sure those are in balance. And then there's ADG or VBG. Those are blood gas tests. They check for metabolic problems. And if there's any suspicion of a heart issue, they'll do cardiac markers. and an ECG, that's an electrocardiogram.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And if they're thinking it might be a pulmonary embolism, they might use scoring systems like PERC or Wells and maybe a D-dimer blood test.
Got it. Okay. And imaging, chest x-rays, CT scans.
Yeah, those can be helpful.
So we've talked about figuring out the cause of shortness of breath. What happens next? Like, how do they decide whether to admit someone to the hospital or if they can go home?
Well, the source pointed out that most of the time, like two-thirds of the time, the history and the physical exam are enough to figure out what's going on.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But the decision to admit really depends on what the underlying problem is and how severe it is.
Right, right.
If someone's really sick, they might need non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, NIPPV, like BiPAP or CPAP.
Okay.
That's where they use a mask to deliver pressurized air.
Oh, yeah, I've heard of that.
Can really help with things like COPD or heart failure. It can even prevent them from needing intubation.
So what about people who are well enough to go home? What should they know?
It's really important that they have follow-up care and that they know what the red flags are.
Yeah.
Like if their shortness of breath gets worse or if they have new chest pain, anything like that. That means they need to come back to the hospital right away.
Okay.